Hey everyone, welcome back to the Data Monk. In today's video, we are going to cover all the basics of Python in just 30 minutes. So we are creating this video so that whenever you are sitting for an interview and you just need to, you know, have a revision of all the basics of the Python programming language, so you can just go through this video and within 30 minutes you will be able to remember all the basic and important concepts of Python. So without wasting any time, let's just dive right into it and learn the basics of Python programming language. So in this particular video, we are going to cover the data types and functions in Python. Alright, so Python is an easy to understand high level language. It is free and open source, it can work on Windows, Linux, Mac. It is also case sensitive, and you can use it on any open source. Other than that, in this particular video, we are going to cover all the data types of Python, that is integers, floats, strings, tuples, lists, sets, dictionaries, and booleans. And we'll be focusing more on the implementation part than on the theory part. So when you'll be done with this video, you'll have all the concept almost graved in your mind. So let's just start. Before we start the data types, I would want you to understand the basic definition of variables, keywords, and identifiers in Python. Alright, so let us revise this. Variables, they are basically the reference name that we give to a particular memory location in a program. They store information which can be manipulated according to the requirement. Alright, next we have keywords. They are reserved words in Python. You cannot manipulate them. These are case sensitive. And example are false, true, break, class, import, return, etc. Important point here, Python is case sensitive, as well as you need to be very careful of the indentation errors in Python. So you need to be very careful when you're writing the any program, you need to be careful of the indents also. Then we have our identifiers. They are user defined names which are used to identify any variable, function, class, or object in a Python. So let us try to understand the concept of these variable, keywords, and identifiers with the help of an example. So we have this particular program where we have a variable A and we have assigned it a value 3, then we have B is equal to 2. Now I have manipulated my variable, I have modified my variable. Instead of 3, now I am saying that A is equal to A plus B. So as it is a variable, we can manipulate them, and if you see the answer that we'll get now when I'm asking it to print A, it is giving me 5 and not 3 because I have manipulated my variable. So you can manipulate the variables, but you cannot manipulate keywords. So for example, we have a keyword 4, and if I assign it a value key1, let us see what happens. So it is actually going to give me an error which says that keywords cannot be assigned values. So I hope now you understand the basic difference between all the three of them, variables, keywords, and identifiers. Now there are some rules that you need to keep in mind while creating any identifier. Alright, when we are creating a user-defined identifier, you need to have just few rules in your mind. That is, the sequence of letters in lowercase and uppercase and digits from 0 to 1, as well as an underscore, can be used. For example, you can use this as an identifier, data monk, data underscore monk. Then we have rule number 2, we cannot use digits to start the name of our identifier. For example, 9 data underscore monk will not be the correct name for an identifier. It will give us an error, right? Then we cannot use keywords as identifier. As I said, we cannot manipulate keywords. Use of special characters like percentage, ampersand, dollar, all these are forbidden. Then although it is not mentioned everywhere, but the limit of identifier is 79 characters. If you go beyond that, it will show you an error. although it is not mentioned in most of the rules, but this is the case, because nobody, you know, reaches to 79 characters when they are naming an identifier, but this is one of the rules, and of course they are case sensitive, right? Moving ahead, we are talking about operators in Python. There are four kind of operators in Python. That is arithmetic operators, which are used to do addition, subtraction, multiplication. Then we have assignment operators to assign particular values. Then we have comparison operators, that is double equal to, greater than equal to, less than equal to, not equal to. And then we have our logical operators, that is and, or, and not. Alright. So this was just a... basic, you know, basic layout of starting any programming language for that matter. Now we are going to talk about the data types in programming, Python programming language. So our first set is integers and floats. Integers are positive or negative whole numbers with no decimal point, while floats represent real numbers and are written with decimal points. For example, if you are dividing two integers, you will always get a float value. Now let me just, if we divide print 9 divided by 8, we are dividing two integers, but we are getting a float value. That is obvious. But in this case also, if you see 40, we are dividing 40 by 5, although they are, although it is completely divisible, but still it is going to give me a float value. It is not going to give me 8, it is going to give me 8.0. So whenever you divide two integers, you will get a float value. Alright, then we have a function in Python which will give you the type also when you are trying to run a particular value. So if I have assigned x is equal to 87 and y is equal to 45 point something, and if I want to see the type of these particular variables, I can just print type of x, print type of y. So if you see, it is going to return us the class values, that is the int value and the float value. So with the help of this type method, you can recognize any value of the variable in a Python program. Alright, then we have our strings. Coming to the next data type, that is our strings. Strings are sequence of characters enclosed within quotes. It could be a single quote, double quote, or triple quote for that matter. They are immutable, that is you cannot modify any string, but you can definitely slice them according to the requirements. Let us try to understand with the help of an example. So we have a name data monk, alright, and now if I want to just get the characters which are starting from the index 1 and ending at index 0. In Python, all the strings, all the indexes, their value starts from 0. So at 0 we have T, at 1 we have H, then at 2 we have E, at 3 there's space, at 4 there's D. So now if I want to get the values which are in between the indexes 1 to 6, so if you see 1 will be considered, this index number 1 will be considered, but 6 won't be considered. So this is going to basically give me value from 1 to 5. So if you see, we get HEDA. Now, instead of positive indexes, you can even use negative indexes for that matter. It starts from the back. So, K has the index minus 1, N has minus 2, O has minus 3, M has minus 4, and so on. So, if I want to get a index, if I want to use negative indexes also, I can do that. So, I can, write print name and my index starts from minus 4 to minus 1. So it is going to give me MON, right? Because minus 4 is this, then minus 2, then minus 1. So it is going to give me this particular string, right? Then if you want to, just get the entire string, you can just start from the index. You can mention the starting index, but you don't have to mention the ending index. So it is going to get me the entire string. Similarly, if you mention the ending index and not the starting index, it is going to print the entire string. Right? So this is basically slicing of strings. You can slice them according to the index values. Moving ahead, we have few of the string functions. There are some of the important string and functions that you need to know. First is our length function, len. So it is going to, obviously as the name suggests, it is going to give me the number of characters in a particular string. So if I run the function len and name of the string, which is name only here, it is going to return me the number of characters, that is 13. Then we have the count function. So if I'm going to write the name of the string dot count and I mention the character which I'm looking for, so it is going to return me the total number of recurrence of a character. So how many times do we have a in data mock? That is 2, right? Then we have a function called ends with. As the name suggests, it is going to tell me that if my string, if a particular string ends with a particular sequence. So does my string name dot ends with nk? If I run that, you see we get the value as true. If I change it to something else, it is going to return me false, right? Then we have another function called find. It is going to return the index of the sequence I'm searching for. So if I'm writing name of the string dot find, I want to find data in a particular string, so it is going to return me the index of that particular value, that is 4. So it is starting from 4, so it is going to return me 4. Alright, then we even have a function for replacing old string with the new string. So if I say name.replace, I want to replace monk with master. So if I do that, now my string will be printed as, instead of data monk, we have the data master. And then the last function that we have is capitalize. So it is going to capitalize the first character of my string. So if I run this name.capitalize function, you need to add parentheses. There are no parameters within that. And you see the first letter, that is T, it has been capitalized and rest of them have been turned to lowercase, right? So these were some of the functions of strings. Till now we have covered integers and floats and string data type in Python. Moving ahead, we have the Boolean functions. So Boolean data type give us true if the value is satisfied, otherwise it is going to give us false. We commonly use them with comparison and logical operators in Python. For example, consider this particular example. We have a variable called percentage, which is 82. Then we have another variable which says that percentage is greater than 60. Then we have another variable called a, which says that percentage is less than 90 and percentage is greater than 80. We are using a logical operator here, we are using a comparison operator here. And then I'm asking to print passed an A. Now, if this passed value is satisfied, it should give me true. Or if it is satisfied, it will give me true. If it is not satisfied, it will give me false. Similarly for A. Now, if you see, a percentage is 82, which is greater than 60, obviously. So this should return me true. And A says that it should be less than 90. Yes, 82 is less than 90 and it should be greater than 80. 82 is greater than 80. So both of these should return me true as my Boolean values. Correct. So we are getting true as the answers. So you can use Boolean values. We normally use them with comparison and logical operators. Right? Moving ahead, one of the important data types in Python programming language is list. You are going to use this data type more than any of other data types that are there in Python. Lists are basically data structures to store values of any data type. They are ordered set of values and are mutable. That is, they can be modified. Before you sit for any interview, just always remember, you know, what data types are mutable and what are not. So till now we know that strings are immutable, but lists are mutables, right? So consider this list one. You need not have all, you know, same data types if you're creating a list. For example, I have two strings. I have an integer value, I have a float value, then again I have a string. So this is absolutely possible to, you know, have lists which have different data types. All right. then you can do list indexing. So you can see what item is at index 0, you can see what item is at index 1. Then again, as I mentioned, indexing can be negative also. You can start from the back, which is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5. And from the beginning, the indexing is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Also, if you want to access the last element, instead of using a negative index, you can just say length of list minus 1. Alright, because we have index starting from 0, that is why we are doing minus 1, and you just learned about the length function above. So if I run this, you see we get the value grapes, because we get length of the string 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, minus 1, 4. So we are basically asking for the fourth index, and at fourth index we have grapes, so it is giving us grapes. Now just like list, we can also do slicing with our list. So if you see, if I want to just get the items from index 1 to 2, I'm going to write 1, colon 3, and if I want to get after 5, I'm just going to mention the starting index and not the end index. So I'm going to get all the values that are present in my list. Now, as I said, that the lists are mutable, so you can change a value at a particular index. At list of the list 1, 0 index, instead of banana, now I want to have kiwi. So if I print this, you'll see that banana has been replaced with kiwi. You can compare these lists. So lists are absolutely mutable. Then there are few functions in the list, that is sorting the list. So you can sort the list in ascending order. If you see, we have got the list sorted, you just need to use the sort function. Then we have a reverse option also, so you can, you know, just print the entire list in the reverse format. So it should start from 6, 7, 4, 1, 2, right? Then we have another function called append. It is just going to add another value to my list. So at the end only, it usually adds the value. So if you see, we have 8 appended to our list. And the next one is insert. So if you want to insert a value at a particular index, you can use the insert function instead of the append function. So you can mention the index and then the value. And if you see, at the second index, 9 will be added. 0, 1, 2. At the second index, 9 value is added. Then we have some of the basic functions like minimum and maximum. So as the name suggests, it is going to give me the maximum from the list and it is going to give me the minimum from the list, right? Then we have pop and remove. So if I say pop 2, it is going to remove the value 2 from my list. And if I say remove 6, it is going to remove from the last, right? Pop actually removes the it basically, here you need to add the index and that value will be removed. In the remove function, you just need to mention the name, the value that needs to be removed. Alright, so here you are mentioning the index and here you are mentioning the value. Then the last important function for list is join. So you can use this join function to, you know, join two values in your list. So you can mention, you know, here I just want to give a one line break, so I'm mentioning what I want to do. Then I'm using dot join function, and then I have the list items. So if you see, Sara and Dhingra will be printed in two lines, because I'm using the next line operator here. If I use dash operator here, then there will be the two items will be joined like this. Alright, so I hope the functions for list were also clear. These are just the basic functions that you just need to have a, you know, idea of that what all you can do with list. Similarly, we have tuples. So our next data type is tuples. Tuples are containers to store similar data types. So like in list, we were storing different kind of data types. In tuples, you can only store similar data types, right? So they are immutable. We cannot make any changes to the tuple. We cannot add, remove, sort, or do any kind of modification in elements in tuple. All right. All you can do is maybe, you know, get the values by mentioning the index. So if I run this, I'm writing top1.index3. So I want the value at index 3. So I'm getting that value. And if I run, if you see, if I'm trying to run that at the index 2, change the value to 2. If I run this, you'll see that we'll get an error because tuple object does not support item assignment. So as I said, tuples are immutable. You cannot modify tuples. You can just see the items that are present in the tuples. And if you see the in list, we were using the square brackets. Here you are using just the normal brackets, the parentheses. And lists are mutable while tuples are immutable. Moving on, we have next data type, that is dictionaries. Dictionaries are basically key value pairs which are indexed, unordered, and again they are mutable. So you can do changes into dictionary, but they do not support polymorphism, that is you cannot have duplicate key values. So you represent a dictionary by the curly braces, and you can mention the key and the value. The key and the value, it can have different data types. You need not have a particular data type in it. And you can you can also add keys and values to your present dictionary. As I said, they are mutable. So I'm adding this another hobby key with the value chess, and then I'm printing. So if you see, when we are printing our original dictionary, I'm getting these values, that is name Sara, age 21, and the score. And when I have in the next step, I have added another value which is giving me name Sara, age 21, score, and my hobby also, right? There are few of dictionary functions like dot items parenthesis. It is going to give me all the items that are present in my dictionary. So in the form of the list, it is going to give me all the items. Then if you want to just see the keys in your dictionary, you can write the name of the dictionary dot keys parenthesis, and you can get all the key values. Then if you want to search for a particular key, and if you want to get the values for it, you'd use the dot get function, and you'll get the values from the particular key. And with dot update, you can even do modifications to your dictionary. So from hobby to chess, I want to modify it to gardening. So if I print it now, you will see hobby is changed to gardening. First it was chess, now it has been changed to gardening. All right, moving on to our last data type that are sets. So they are unordered, unindexed, immutable data structures in Python. They are non-repetitive values, and they are basically used to perform mathematical operations like union, intersection, and difference. So we have set, and if I want to union it with another set, it is just going to display a new set with all the items. And if I want to do an intersection with dot intersection function, it is going to return me the common element from both the lists. So this data type is not used that much, but this is one of the data type that you need to know. Moving on, we are going to discuss if else and elif function in Python. We use these clauses when decision making is involved. If a particular condition is satisfied, that set of code is executed, else some other block of code is executed. So let us understand this with the help of an example. For example, we have to check if a year is leap year or not. For that, you need to see if that year is divisible by 400. If it is divisible by 400, then it is a leap year. Otherwise, it isn't a leap year. So it says that we have taken a variable year, and I have asked for enter the year. Now, if this year variable is divisible by 400, if it is divisible by 400, we'll say the entered year is leap year. Elif, that is going into another condition, that this is basically the combination of else and if. So elif, if year is divisible by 4 also, then also it is a leap year. This is basically for the decade years. And if both these conditions are not satisfied, then this else clause is executed, which says that the printed year is not a leap year. Alright, so I'll run this function, run this program for you. I'm entering a year, say 2015. And it says that enter year is not a leap year. So this is how you use if, else, and elif in Python. Then we have loops in Python. So there are two kinds of loop, for and for loop and while loop. We use loops in Python when we want to repeat set of instructions. So while condition, in while loop, first the condition is checked. If it is true, then the body of loop is evaluated, otherwise not. So consider this program where we need to add n natural numbers. So consider we have a variable called n and we have some variable as 0 and we have another variable called I. Now I want to execute a loop when till my I is less than 200. Alright, so whenever you are doing a while loop, you'll mention the condition, then you have the body of the loop which says that sum is equal to sum plus I, and then you have a increment function which says that the value of I is increasing till it is less than or equal to the n value, which is 200. So if I run this, you'll see we get the sum of all the values from 1 to 200, that is adding n natural numbers. Alright, this was a pretty simple example for that. Moving ahead, we are using for loop. It is used to iterate through a sequence like list, tuples, etc. Alright, so for example, we have a list L, and if I want to run through all the items in the list, what I'm going to do is for I in L. So this in clause is used whenever you are using the for loop. So it is going to give me all the items from the loop. So it basically iterates through the entire sequence. Then you also use this range function for loop. It is an inbuilt function which is used to generate a sequence of characters where we can specify start, stop and step size. So this is the syntax which says range, start index, stop index and the step size. So if I'm saying that for I in range 5, print data monk. So it is going to print data monk 5 times, right? Then if you have a question that print all odd numbers between 1 to 100, alright? But if, as I said, we have a starting index, that is 1. We have a stopping index called 100. But as we need odd numbers, so I'm going to use the step size also. So because I want to, have just the odd numbers, the step size will be 2. So it is going to skip a value and then print my list. So if you see, I have 1, 3, 5, 7 because it is skipping the values because we have a step size as 2, right? You can even use for loop with else clause, that after this for loop is concluded, you can say else print completed. So when this entire loop is executed and when it's end, you want to print complete. So you can use the else clause for that. So I'm using the same function 1 to 10. And after we have all these values printed with step size 2, it is going to write complete. Right? Now let us consider an example question to print a factorial of a number. Alright, so this is pretty simple. Here we are going to use our elif clauses and our for loop also. So we have taken a number and we have taken an input where it says enter a number. Then we have a variable called factorial. We have set it to 1. Now if the value of this number that we have entered is less than 0, print factorial of negative number doesn't exist. If the number of value is 0, then the factorial is going to be 1, obviously. Else, if both these conditions are false, then this loop is going to be executed else. Within else, we have a nested for loop which says that for I in range 1 to num plus 1, alright, because we are obviously going to execute it to num plus 1 value, factorial is equal to factorial into the value of I. And then we are directly going to print the factorial of that number. So this is something that you need to remember whenever you are doing a factorial. Factorial is equal to factorial into I. And we are running this under the for loop, under the range 1 to the number that we have entered plus 1. So if you see, we'll get the factorial. Let us say we want to get the factorial for 23. So we have got the value, which is 258. Oh, that is quite bigger number, right? So moving ahead, we have functions in Python. Functions are nothing but group of statement or block of code which perform a specific task when called. So we use functions basically so we don't have to write the same code again and again. This is the syntax of a function. You write def, name of the function, the parameters, then you have the doc string. Doc string is basically the first statement that you start in a function. Then you have the block of code and then you have the return expression. For example, we have this function for odd and even. We have named the function even odd. We have a parameter num. Now if num modulus 2 is equal to 0, print even, else print odd. So, and this is how you call the function. You write the name of the function and you just mention the number or whatever parameter that you are calling. This is how you call the function. There are two types of function in Python. First is built-in functions that we already have in the programming language, that is print, that you use the most often used built-in function, that is the print. Then we have range, we have discussed this. Then we have user-defined functions, which are basically created by the users to execute the program. Alright, like we just created that even or odd inbuilt function here. Then the arguments in function, they could be of three types. The function could have no arguments, so the parentheses are empty. It can have one argument, two arguments, more than one arguments. Then it can also have a default value, so you can just directly set the value, so you don't have to mention that whenever you're calling the function. So now we have covered all the basics of Python programming language. We have covered the data types, we have covered the if-else, for loop clauses and everything, and we have covered functions also. So if you see, within 30 minutes we have covered all the basic of Python along with the examples. Now here we have few of the practice questions also, using the same basics only, and these are some of the questions which are asked in all of your data science interviews when you are, you know, they need to check if your basics are clear. So our first program is to check if a number is palindrome or not. So palindrome is a word, number, phrase or sequence of character which reads the same as backward or forward, such as madam. So if you see, if I read madam like this, it is giving me MADAM. If I read it from backward, it is still giving me MADAM, right? So Python program for this would be, we have entered a value, we have stored our original value into a variable called temp, because we are going to make changes to the original number. So to maintain the originality, we have already stored in a variable called temp. Then we have another variable called rev. Now, because I need to start from the back, we are going to use this particular block of code a lot of time when you need to access the last digit or the last character of a sequence. So for that, what you're going to do is, while num is greater than 0, this particular code will be executed till your value of num is greater than 0. So what you're going to do is, you'll take the variable digit and you'll divide the number. You'll actually do modulus of a number, okay, and you'll modulus it by 10. So whenever you modulus, you'll get the remainder, right? So that remainder is stored in the value, in the variable digit. So if I, for example, if I divide 3, 4, 5 modulus 10, it is going to give me the remainder 5, right? So this will be stored in the digit. So this will help me access the last number. Now, the rev variable, it is going to be rev into 10 plus the digit. So if you see, from 3, 4, 5 in the digit, now I have the value 5 when I modulus it by 10, right? Now, in the next variable, what I need to do is, I'll multiply it by 10 and then add 5. So this will give me 50, right? Right? And then we are going to divide the number by 10. So now my number is reduced to 34. Now this is going to be executed till the value of num is greater than 0. If the temp, that is the original value, equals to the num, equals to the reverse actually, the rev value, then the value is palindrome, otherwise it is not a palindrome number. So this is basically, this particular block of code is something that you need to always remember whenever you are whenever you want to get the last digit or last character of a particular sequence. So you are modulusing it by 10. Then you are multiplying the variable with 10 plus adding the previous digit, and then you are shortening the number. You're basically dividing the number by 10. So it is going to be executed till num is greater than 0. Then similarly, we have another question which says that program for nth Fibonacci number. What is a Fibonacci number? It is sum of previous two values. For example, we have this list. We have 0 and 1, right? So the sum of this is 0 plus 1 is 1. Now sum of 1 and 1 is 2. Now sum of 1 and 2 is 3. So it is basically sum of previous values. Sum of 2 and 3 is 5. Then sum of 5 and 8 is 13. So this is how your Fibonacci series work. This is also a pretty simple question. All you need to do is declare two variables, wherein the first will be 0, of course, and b will be 1. It is always going to start with 0 and 1. Now if n, the value which you have entered, so we are using a function here called Fibonacci. If the value you have entered, n, is less than 0, then you will say incorrect input. If n is equal to 0 only, then it is going to return a, which is 0 itself. If n is equal to 1, it is going to return me b, which is 1. Else, what you are going to do is, you are going to run a loop which says, for I in range 2 to n, you are going to run from 2, because 0 and 1 we have covered. So from 2 to n, that is end of the list, you're going to declare a variable which says that c is equal to a plus b, that is sum of the previous two values, and then you're going to just swap the values where a is equal to b, b is equal to c, and then you're going to return the value b, that is your second value here, because we need the sum of two previous terms. So this was a simple program for Fibonacci series. Then we have another program which says to check if strings are anagram or not. So for that, you can see for a string to be anagram or not, the string should contain same set of characters. For example, listen and silent, they have same characters. It has L, it has I, it has E, it has N, right? So you need to just check that. We have a very simple program for that also. Create a function called anagram, wherein we have two strings, string 1 and string 2. Now we are going to do type conversion, and we are going to convert these strings into list. So I have converted list, we have stored it in list 1 is equal to list of string 1, and then we have stored another string 2 in list 2. Now we are going to sort this list with our sort functions. Then we have declared two variables where position is equal to 0 and match is equal to 2. Now if both of these are conditions are satisfied, while position is less than the length of string and match is also true, we'll check if list 1 position is equal to list 2 position, and then we need to increment the value of position. If this is true, this will keep on running if the value is true. If not, we'll set the variable match to false, and it will get the will return the value match. So if the match comes out to be true, the strings are anagram, otherwise they are not. So if I'm going to run this particular function, I'm calling the function anagram, and I have two strings, listen and silent. Now as they have same set of characters, it is returning me true. If it wouldn't have been same set of characters, it would have returned me solved. So what you need to do is just convert your strings into list, sort your list, and then just run this while loop to check if the position of list 1 is equal to position of list 2, and then keep incrementing the value of the position, right? Okay, now we have a last question, which is to check if a number is Armstrong or not. We are inputting a number called, a value called num. Then we are declaring a function here called check Armstrong. Armstrong number is basically, say a positive number n is said to be Armstrong if sum of nth power of each digit gives me the number itself. For example, we have the number 153. So we have how many digits? 3. Now the value 1 to the power 3 plus 5 to the power 3 plus 3 to the power 3 should give me the number itself, that is 153. Then our number is said to be Armstrong, right? So we are going to declare a function called check armstrong, and we have a parameter num in it. Then to get the order, like if I want to see how many digits are there in my number, I'm going to store that in the variable order. I'm just going to convert my number into string, and then I'm going to run this len function to get the number of values that I have in my number. Alright, then I have another variable called sum which I have set to 0. Now we have a original number. I'm storing my original number in a variable called original because I'm going to make the modifications to my original value. So now we have this again. We are going to run this particular block of code because I need to reference the last value first. So as I explained you above also, while num is greater than 0, you'll divide the number, modulus the number by 10 to get the last value, the last number. You'll store that in digit, and then to calculate n powers, we'll keep on adding it to the variable sum. Okay, so we are multiplying. This particular operator is used for the power, double asterisk sign. So digit to the power order. Order is giving me the length of my number, and then we are going to keep them adding. And we are going to do this till no number is left. So till num is greater than 0, we are going to execute this particular code. And it is going to tell me, it is going to give me my number. Now if the sum that we get from this particular code is equal to original, then the number is armstrong, else it is not armstrong. Alright, so now I have called the function check armstrong. They are saying enter a value. I say 153. And we see the number is armstrong. So if you check 1 to the power 3 plus 5 to the power 3 plus 3 to the power 3, it is going to give you 153 only. And so the number is armstrong. So this was end of our video. We have covered all the basics along with the practice, along with practice questions, the basic questions that could be asked in your interviews. I hope I was worth the time. So keep practicing and have a good day. See you in the upcoming videos.